And that's the Hilbert key. Maybe I can still review where we are. We had that this component of the fixed point locus without permission moderate point partition partition 1 1 1 parameterizes as defined where E is a I thought it would be one. So we can write the I equal to the huge of the zero dimensional scheme, tensorized by line bundles. So and E I minus 1 S for all I except for I equal to 0, namely. And so this will indicate that Li minus 1 cancel all tensor fields. Okay. All I then introduce the Hilbert scheme. So this was, so we have Sn. And we also have for beta beta. This is two of a set one. And we have corresponding linear system beta product of the corresponding linear system projective space. So then we have the nested Hilbert scheme. This is some instance correspondent in this Sn times beta. So it would be Sn beta. So this is the set of all your super two dimensional subschemes and curves. So the slice inside Sn beta, and it's such an instance corresponding to I minus the I. Okay, so we have this incidence correspondence. Obviously, that's something difficult to study. But now, so one can show that, so from this description here, we see that this space is isomorphic to the union of some of these integral spins correspond. I can just write it down. I mean, it's a bit, obviously, in theory, I introduce all the notation so that I use it afterwards, but as I will wipe it out, it doesn't really, you know, I just introduce it and then you will have everything in mind. So we have this, but A1, A R minus 1, where the AI are some classes in the cohomology, like the beta I. And the second cohomology is just this for that 4 minus some I. Well, I just had it down. There's some simple expression, there's obviously the section number. This union of these S and beta such that we get the correct first term class and the correct second term class. Now the if I, our sheaf is supposed to be a direct sum like that, we can compute the first and second term class. And the formula that we get is that first term class is congruent to some I from 1 R I times KS. This is some one. That's I. And the second term is equal to the sum n, it's just the sum of the n i's plus r minus 1 squared plus this 4 k s minus beta 1. Can see this is just a condition. If you compute, if you want to try to compute first and check third class of this of the bundle made like this, you will get this congruent T1 mod R if this condition is called here in the second third class is six. So it's just this condition.
And then
we have a virtual fundamental class. So we have a virtual fundamental class on this S and beta, which coincides, which was defined by one of four and Thomas. Which coincides with that from this And in fact, one can exist the. So what one actually does is they give push forward. So this product here, which is much more useful. So this formula for this push forward, because obviously this is a nice smooth space, this is a product of projective spaces, whereas this is some complicated incidence correspondence, so it's difficult to work on that. So we have this. And this is in terms of universal ideal sheaves. So on every S of the Hilbert scheme of n points, we have the universal subscheme. So the family of subschemes parameterized by S, and we have the ideal sheaf. The n. And the ideal sheaf. Isaac. And these obviously play a good role, a big role in understanding this. And basically, in terms of these, the virtual fundamental chance can be written down in terms of these and desired fitness. If you know this push forward product, then Lothar star. It's just written as an Euler class, more or less, with the product I 1 is that written in the way of the class beta I, but that's always the price. You take the Euler class of R star. So just the vector size tensor OS, tensor O, whatever O is space. So this is a trivial vector bundle. So this doesn't do anything minus pi. So obviously we have pi. Projection by of B. So I should maybe say here I have this, and then get this side down. I minus one. Beta I, where I minus is a pullback of the universal ideal sheaf. So in product, this product in SN beta. And vectors, from S minus the I and so we take this difference, which is then an indicator group. Of the whole thing. And this is not quite it. We multiply this. So we are here on Sn. So this is now in Sn times beta. And so we take here times Sn. So multiple point in all the projective spaces here. So in some sense, this thing just lives by itself on this part of Hilbert. Okay, so we have this one. So this is one ingredient. We know what the fundamental class of this thing is. Then we have to see. So we have to compute. So the follows and we can compute one plus s. We want to compute this thing. No, because we have, instead of doing working on this stupid thing, we push forward to product. Then here with the point class, if we push forward to this, we just are on this. We still we have to just take the part which has to be zero in these coordinates. So then it doesn't get killed by multiplying by the point. So computing is n. But what we need to compute is not just the integral of one over this virtual fundamental class, but we have to use this localization thing. So we have to integrate one over the Euler number of the virtual number. Which is what we have, times order number of the normal one. So we have this virtual. So this is the definition. This is the moving part of the virtual tangent function of this n, I mean where this is n. And moving part means it's the part where the action of C star, where the weights of the action are non-zero. Okay. So we therefore have to determine what this bundle is, or what the Euler class is, or equivalently, as this is anyway on the moving part, we have to determine what this restriction of the tangent bundle. And so one can do that. In some sense, it's quite, it's a thing relatively routine. We do that and we get something right. So basically, what should the tangent bundle be? I mean, it will be basically something like X1EE, where E is the universal sheaf. Maybe not quite, because it should be minus R hom pi of E to E, or something like that, maybe trace free. And so we have to therefore write down what is the universal sheaf here. And we know what the universal sheaf is because I've just written it. I mean, we have basically written it down, only have to make it to globalize. So on S times this N eta, we put Li equal to nine but Li tensor tensor.
Looks kind of unlikely. Okay, so
great. So and I equal to the tensor product. I mean, it doesn't matter for precise what that is. Well, this is a projective space. I do it like this. So this is the line bundle on. So we take, so this means I pull back the Li on S, right? And I put pull back this orb one from here. So I get the line bundle first on the product of these two and then on this triple product.
So nice.
Line bundle, so I press pull back. And so where the Li, my line bundle on S, such that the S minus the Li is equal to C1 for Li. C1 for I for all I, and the sum from I into 0 for R minus 1. The first transfer is our given C1. So this basically just, it's wiped out, but this just described what these bundles are that are there, if I just globalize them. And let the universe. I which already had it in universal idea chief tensor is Li tensor T to the minus one. The T is just means that we have a trivial line bundle. Is not equivalent to trivial, namely, we have this star action given by C minus A is equal to just the multiplication of T of A. So, five of us that multiplication of T. That's T is kind of the character. So, this is this universal sheaf. And then we can just. And so now we have this equivalent X bundle, which is just globalizing this with KS. So we have on this thing. I don't precisely say, but the claim is there's a tautological such map, which comes from the fact that this has tautological sections. I mean, we have the O minus one has a tautological section. If I did it right, then there's a tautological map here, so which just comes from the universal property. So we have this, and obviously KS means pullback from S. And then can compute this tangent bundle. There's some formula, namely, if I take this virtual tangent bundle, restrict it to beta, then this is equal to. Right, like this now. This is R. So, what is it? This is R star form E from E tensor KS, which means get to the mass from P, the E one tensor T minus, so this K theory. In some sense, the thing we had before, we had the obstruction theory gave us precisely that we have the tangent and the obstruction, and it's precisely given by this. So this gives us this. And so now can just put it together. So we have all this data, so we can write down the formula what we need to integrate over the original point. And if you look at it, just to make it here, we have here this E is given mostly, I mean, there's this stupid, this L is just the line bundle on the surface, so this is easy. This T is the invariant weight, but the non-trivial thing is this universal ideal sheaf that we have on the Hilbert team. And you always have to look at a home key of this with itself or something like that. So what we're into, and it's a, this E is a direct sum of such ideal sheaves twisted by line bundle. So what we will be interested in is the X sheaves of one universal ideal sheaf with another or with itself. If we're able to compute this, we can compute everything. So I write this down as an explicit formula, which is a little bit long, but then so we have to just put it together.
Yes.
If I want to compute this generating of this part of the Lothar-Witten generating function corresponding to this partition. So we have the first term plus this second term plus once, and this then this is something. So something. Also, we have two things plus some over all people. And all to be A, where A is just one to this pattern. We have, there was a shift with the second term class corresponding to this Q. So we have Q of A plus N. N is the sum of B and I's. And then comes the product. We have the product of thickness I. One R minus one is a position invariant of AI, and then times integral. So M we have to integrate over S N, which for the moment I can just write gamma of N. First term of the second one from T. In equivalent cohomology, it's just a variable. No, but you know what? Okay, so have this. So we have to see what this is. And there's a, I can write down this formula for that, which is just what we had before. So gamma A N will be equal to the sign which I'm going to write, to E in the denominator, we have this Euler class, the Euler class of the moving part of this tangent bundle. So this is E of R star from pi. E and the S. Okay, so this is just what's written there, and we are supposed to take, however, the moving part, so where the weight of the action is non-trivial. So I write just M, take it up like this. And in the numerator, we have what I had written down before, what gives us the fundamental class. It's no longer there, which was E of R. Yeah, I think this product gamma of S. And we subtract the corresponding thing with the H. So the full breadth of the X minus this. Then we take the equivalent Euler path. This was basically what we had for the tension. So it's a completely explicit thing. And all these things, as you can see, are just the tension of the VHG by itself. So we can now start. Time to compute. I mean, for the moment, I want to. What kind of thing? I want to give the this structure theorem. I had stated the structure result of Laarakker. So this is basically return to the old cobordism idea. Based on the fact that if you have an integral over Hilbert schemes of points of some natural cohomology class, which are even given, either given by topological bundles or by push forwards from S times the Hilbert scheme of universal ideal sheaves twisted by some line bundles from the surface, this can always be expressed as a universal formula in terms of the obvious classes which you can see, namely the Chern class of the line bundle, the canonical class of the surface, and chi of S. And so we want to use that. So what we really need to do in order to prove it, we need to know. So these are all just stupid numbers. This is all there also in the original form. We need to know what you can say about these integrals. So let S be any smooth projective surface. And if we take A equal to A1 some classes second homology. Now I want to, so these are the things I want to know. So I put them into generating series and I want to see what I can say about. So put TSA. So for this normalized series. So this is for G S A. That's a Q. Generating functions is one over something I call gamma of A, which is fine, which is just could just be the constant part of this thing. Times sum over all N. And it just so Q so the sum of these integers integral over S of this thing gamma A okay. I should maybe say here so when we do, okay, let me just do. So we have this. does what you get when this n is equal to the zero vector. So with this, we have normalized the thing in such a way that the power series starts with one. And so, as you can imagine, and maybe I don't write it down, there's this elementary formula for this. So you, if you look at the formula here, you can express it by whatever Goettsche-Lippmann-Roch or whatever in terms of something on the Hilbertism of points. In particular, if you push forward just to a point, you have some Goettsche-Lippmann-Roch formula which happens on the surface itself and gives you some simple intersection numbers. So I can also write it down so that we just know that there's no mystery. And this is minus one. Whatever, it's just a number that you get. So we have this, and now so we need to compute this GSA, I mean, or to say something about it. Okay. So as I said, by definition, this gamma A n t was expressed in terms of transverse of this universal ID sheet, and then the push forward, and these nine bundles A I. And so there is the cobordism, so gamma A. Okay, so we have an expression for this. And so if you just look it down, it's expressed in terms of this is divided or whatever. And so so now the old cobordism invariant said. Integral over n over gamma a n is a polynomial. Right. In the numbers L to S, S squared, A S times A I for all I and A I. The universe could not show is a universal polynomial. So that means there's a formula which is independent on X, which depends only on obviously what this n is, what the a is, which expresses this as a polynomial. So the original proof if any difference theorem was just for the case of looking just at the Hilbert scheme of points on the surface, here we have a product Hilbert scheme, but the proof is easy extended to that case. And it already includes these universal ideas. And the statement is so that easily adapted from the original proof. So look at this. So anyway, now, so this is the first part. So this thing is just universally such a polynomial. So what more can we say? And then the next thing is, so this is supposed to be the cobordism invariant. The second part is the multiplicativity. So we want to see how it depends on this state. I think if I look at the generator. And then this is very nice. It's also an old trick is that if you know, so now what does one do? Assume S is a disjoint union of surfaces. We have two disjoint projective surfaces, and our A is, so to speak, is probably, I write it as A1 disjoint union A2. That means that A is restricted to S1, A1, A restricted to S2. And now one has to look at the formulas that, I mean, I wiped out what happens. So how can I express the thing for S and A in terms of these? And the way it's done, you can see it's somehow a product of things over the parts. So if you work it out, you find out that it is relatively easy to check, but you have to look at the actual formulas. That so the first thing that we have to see is obviously if I look at Sn, what is it? I mean, here we have these tuples, but anyway, if it was just a Hilbert scheme of n points like this, if you have a subscheme of length n on disjoint union of two projective varieties, it's there will be a subscheme of some length n1 on S1, subscheme of some length n2 on S2, such that n1 plus n2 is equal to n. And you have to go through all possibilities. So if you do this like this for the product of them, it's still true. So this will be the disjoint union over all n1 plus 2 n. Vector sum of n of S1 to the n1 times S2 to the n. So it's a product like that. And then if you work it out, you find out that the integral, so on this thing, if you take the contribution over this product of the thing of A1 and A2, this will just be the product of the one of this with A1 and this with A2. It's not automatic, it depends on the formula that we are given, no? But it is at least understandable. And so from this it follows, so we get that if I take G associated with this disjoint union, we have A is disjoint and so like this, and this is just the product. The generating function is just the product. It means term by term you get the product, and then the generating function will be the product. So this is this G is one times, so this was of two. 1 here, and if this is okay. And now, so now the point is that this tells you that this generating function here must satisfy a product formula, must be product over contribution for the AI. Here it says each individual term is a polynomial in these, but it's actually much simpler. It follows formally. This thing has A, so it only depends on these numbers, but in fact, it depends on these numbers in particular ways. So A of Q to the child class, E of Q, the K squared. So that's I equals 1, so R minus 1 of the EI of Q, the AI times KS, and products I more than A. Which is of E I Q. Where these are universal power series in Q, so they do not depend on anything. So basically, the point is the following. So this tells you that if you can associate, if the numbers of your intersection numbers that we have here are those which correspond to this situation, then it's the product of these things. If it's a product of many such terms, then it will be the product of all these. Now, the combinations of intersection numbers that occur as products of the correct number of factors, you know, as the intersection number of the product of factors will actually be variously dense in the space of all these numbers. And so therefore, knowing that you have a product structure when this thing can be written as a union like this now, not of two, but of many, proves that it must in general have a structure like that, and this formula. So it is a formal thing. Okay, there's one final thing to get the Laarakker structure formula, which was slightly better because you had a few more less generation functions. We just have note for the algebraic classes. Well, because remember that we had always to take the Seiberg-Witten invariant of AI in front. The Seiberg-Witten class means that the Seiberg-Witten of AI is non-zero. And obviously we have only contributions when the Seiberg-Witten of AI is non-zero. So for the Seiberg-Witten class with AI, we have that AI times K is squared. This is the fact. And so therefore, we can eliminate these terms and absorb them here. No? AI times KS is equal to AI squared. So I can take this thing with the AI times KS and multiply it with the term AI squared here. So that's relation to I with the same frequency. Maybe call them now EIJ. So this was the structure form where these are universal power series. There was one more thing that we found. So by specializing case as a CKP surface, note that these things are completely universal. So if I can compute what happens in the case of CKP surface, I determine some of the power series. And in that case, one can, so there are basically no basic classes, but this term is still there, it finds that AQ minus 1 to the R minus 1 divided by R times delta of 2 to the R, where delta of 2 is, as usual, the discriminant function. Okay, so here one can just explicitly do some geometry. I mean, look what happens on the K3 surface. Somehow, if one look what happens, most terms, many terms cancel, are not there, and one can compute it. But then didn't want to go into that. Now I have 3 minutes. So this was this separate theme of Laarakker, but now we can kind of base ourselves on this and try to. So what we're interested in now is to compute explicitly what the other power series are. We want to know what they are. So here we see some modular forms. Physics says that all these things should be somehow expressible in terms of modular forms, although they don't tell us which ones. And so we want to try to do that. So I can at least set it up. The next time I get it. So what to determine explicitly. Okay. So remember that this GSA, we have defined what this GSA is for any surface and for any tuple of just classes in the second cohomology, then you don't have this rule. And remember, you know, if I write the computation of just for EI classes, tuples of class in the second cohomology, we can just try to fix some surfaces which are particularly nice and some line bundles on them which are particularly nice and compute for those. If we have enough examples and can compute for those, we determine all the power series. So okay. We know already what AQ is, but if we confirm it, so for this, compute, we generate as G S A. For sufficiently many examples. So for the power series that we have, we actually have to do it with the previous version, also with the EIJs, there were more, because we don't have this anymore. We have general A's. R plus 1 plus 2 plus 1. I don't know if that's actually correct. Alpha, E alpha. The formation of toric surfaces. And toric surface just means that you have an action of C star and C star on the surface of many fixed points, and the line bundles should be equivalent line bundles for this action. And actually, the surfaces we just take, so S alpha will always be either equal to P1 times P1 or P2, but not big mystery. And then the line bundles will be something with O of one or of minus one, whatever, so something completely trivial. So maybe I will anyway have to repeat this as my time is out. So I can just say then please and I find that these maybe I still write it down. And we can just compute it by the fridge. And that's how we will then get some formulas. But anyway, maybe I stop here as the time I think is up. No. Thank you. Okay, thanks. Okay.